Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
When you have got a question and you just can't figure it out, just give us a shout and call the Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaremba.
And I'm Donna Mineo. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Here's how it works. Teachers from Dial a Teacher are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you would like help with your homework, call Dial a Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
You can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your question.
Right, it's Tuesday, and that means it's time for tonight's creature teaser.
All right, this creature is a great hunter and uses tall perches or flies high in the air to search for prey. It can spot a mouse from 100 feet in the air. Imagine being able to see something from a window on the 10th floor. When it spots a rodent or lizard or other prey, this carnivore swoops down and grabs it in its talons. It will then return to its perch to eat.
This creature mates for life and will build a stick nest high above the ground. The male and female use the same nest every year and take turns sitting on the eggs to keep them warm. Babies are born with soft white feathers that turn brown as they mature. This creature is named for its brick red tail feathers. Male and females look the same, but females are larger. If you think you can solve the creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904, or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Every correct response be added to our Hotline Hall of Fame, earn enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season. All right.
We got some homework
yes,
tonight. Hi, Tyler. How are you?
Good.
Hi,
good.
Tyler.
I'm going to go over to the board. Why don't you tell me what kind of problem we're going to be doing?
So it's two times.
Okay.
And 5 + 3 in parentheses.
Okay.
And then it's cubed.
Cubed or squared?
Squared.
Okay.
Minus 12.
Okay, I've got that written on the board. So it looks like you're working on order of operations.
Yep.
Okay, so what did your teacher tell you to do first?
She told me to put the parentheses first.
Do the parentheses first. Okay, so we have 5 + 3 inside the parentheses. What do you got?
8.
So I'm going to rewrite that. And this is something you really need to remember to do because trying to do it in your head is kind of hard, okay?
Yeah.
All right. So now what would you do? You got the parentheses done.
I would go with the cube. That's what they told me.
Okay, so you mean the squared?
Yeah, the squared.
Okay. So what's 8 squared? What does that mean?
It's like 8 to the power of 4 or 8 squared.
Yep. So 8 squared means 8 times 8.
Yeah.
Okay. And I just rewrote that on the board so that all our viewers can see that. So what's 8 times 8?
64.
64. Excellent. So now I have 2 times 64. Minus 12. All right, so now what do I do?
Go 64 times 2.
Yes, now, do you need some help doing that? Let's do that off to the side here, okay?
Okay.
All right, what's 4 times 2?
I got 128.
Oh, wow, you did it ahead of me, 128, great job. All right, so what's 128, and then we bring the minus 12 down. And what do you have for that?
116.
116, that's perfect. Do you have another one? I love doing these.
Let's see, I got three times, and then parentheses, 6 plus 4.
Okay.
And then on the side, it's minus 12.
Is there a squared or anything with that?
No.
Okay, so you have 3 parentheses, 6 plus 4, and your parentheses, minus 12?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, let's get this one done for you, too, okay?
Okay.
All right, what are we going to do first?
The 6 plus 4.
And what do you get?
10.
Okay, perfect. So 3 times 10 minus 12. What are you going to do now?
The 3 times 10.
Excellent. And what is that?
30.
So 30 minus 12. Oh, boy, I bet you know that answer before me. I even write it off to the side, don't you?
Yep.
What is it?
It's
18. You know, you're perfect at this. You can come up here and teach that. That's great. Thank you for the fun.
Yeah.
All right. I'll talk to you later.
Okay. Bye.
Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial a Teacher's open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
All right, we got a question from Dial a Teacher, and sometimes the questions aren't the greatest. And this is one of those instances. I want to work it with you guys so you can see.
Yeah, because it's really interesting.
Yes.
I really like it.
So here we have, and I got it up here. It says, this is from a student from Syracuse, and we have a container, all of quarters, is 3/7 full. And there are 40 quarters in the container. What is the value of the container if it was full of quarters? So first thing we did is we read the question. Next, we're going to underline some stuff. We're dealing with quarters, all right? And we know how much, because we deal with money all the time, what a quarter is and how much it's worth. We know that we have, right now, there's 3/7 of the container is full. And they want us to find out, they're telling us that there's 40 quarters in the container, which will fill it to 3/7. And they want us to find out what is the container going to be worth when it's completely full. All right, so we know that each quarter here is worth 1/4 equals 25 cents, all right? So knowing that, we can say, okay, if we know that there's 40 quarters, how much is in there already? And if I take lines and let's say I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I have 7 sections there. And if I have 3 of those, 1, 2, and 3, I know that that's 40 quarters. And I can go ahead and say another 3 sections also is going to be 40 quarters. So if I say we also have 40 here, I need to find out what that last section is, and I'm going to use a question mark because I don't know exactly how many quarters are in there. And this is why this question is kind of a little awkward when we get to this, all right? If I do the math and find out how much money I actually have in 3/7, I can say, okay, I have 40 quarters. And if I do 40 quarters and I know that there's 4 quarters in a dollar, all right, I can divide by 4, which gives me 1, goes in 4, subtract, gives me 0, and 0. So I know that 40 quarters is the same as $10, all right? So now I know I have, right now I have $10, all right? And if I go up again, I also know that another 40 quarters is going to give me $10. And here's where it's the awkward part. They want us to find out what is the 1/7 of $10, okay? So here we're going to go through and we're going to figure out, and this is why it doesn't work out and it's an awkward question. If I take $10, all right, and if I divide this, and I'm going to use my decimals because I know I'm dealing with money, and if I divide this by 7, because I want to figure out, actually I got to go 40 because I want to find out how many is in, and we're going to go quarters. I have 40 quarters. And I'm going to find out how much 1/7 of the whole container is, all right? Do I want to do 7 or 3? I want to do 3. Donna, we going?
Pardon?
If I want to do 7, this is why me and Donna were talking about this, why it's kind of an awkward question, all right? If I have 40 quarters and it's worth $10, I want to find out the total for all 7, right? So I'm going to go 40 divided by 7.
No, by 3. by three, because I want to find out what's in 1/3 of my container. Each one is going to add up to 40. So if I divide 40 by three, I'm going to move this down a little bit so I'm not confusing with myself up here. So I get $40, or 40 quarters divided by three. Three goes into four one time. I subtract, I get three. I subtract, I get one, and here. And here's where we get the awkwardness, because when I divide three into 10, I get three. Three times three is nine, and now I have a repeating decimal, and it's gonna go three, three, three. So I can't have 1/3 of a quarter. All right, so if I round this down, because the rules of rounding say if it's lower than five, that means I'm gonna have 13 quarters in one section. And if I do the math, 13 times 0.25, I get 15, five here, the one up there, five and one is six, I carry a zero. Two times three is six, two times one is two, I get 12, two here, the one up there, I get $33.25 per level, per seventh. And if I do that times three, $3.25 times three, because I know right now I have 40 quarters in there, I don't add up to what my money equals by number wise. So I get 15, five here, the one up there, I get six and one is seven, and I get $9.75. So this is the awkward part about this, all right? If I say that I have $10 for 40 quarters and that's 3/7 of a container, a seventh is actually 325 and it doesn't add up to the total of $10, all right? So here's where we're rounding down. So when I say, what is this top level gonna be? That's gonna be $3.25. I have to round it down because I can't have 1/3 of a quarter. So now when we add it up, how much total do we have? We have in our container, it's gonna be $10. That's 3/7, plus 10 more dollars, that's another 3/7, plus the 1/3, which is gonna be $3.25. When we add this up, I get 5, 2 and 0 is 2, carry my decimal, 3, and I'm gonna have $23.25 in my container when it's full. So this is, again, one of those times when your teacher's gonna give you a question thinking it's gonna work out, and it's a kind of an awkward question. So I'm glad you worked with me and saw that, you know, even us teachers have questions, we bounce things off one another, and it helps us learn. Thanks a lot.
King Philip came over for great spaghetti is a silly way to remember the classification of animals and plants in science. The classification order is kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species.
All right.
That was a really interesting problem. Now, when you were over there and you said you were dividing by the three,
yes,
it's because we were only talking about the section in the bottom and we only had three sections.
And we knew
that's
there was 40 quarters.
You divided by three,
right?
Not the seven.
Gotcha, because okay. The whole container had seven.
Right.
All right,
okay.
Cool. So I'm glad we clarified that. We're gonna go back to the questions in just a minute, but we head to the Binghamton Zoo to learn about the large rodent that has quills. Take a look.
The prehensile-tailed porcupine's scientific name is Coindu prehensilis. There are about 29 species of porcupine. There are Old World porcupines, which are found in Africa and Europe. And there are New World porcupines, which are found in North and South America. And then there's a group of prehensile-tailed porcupines, and there are 7 species of those. Old World porcupines tend to be larger, and New World porcupines tend to be a little bit smaller. And then the prehensile-tailed porcupines live more in the trees, and they have a long, powerful tail that they can use to grasp tree branches. Prehensile-tailed porcupines, and actually all porcupines, are rodents. So they're closely related to things like mice, rats, squirrels, guinea pigs, and hamsters. Prehensile-tailed porcupines in the wild eat mostly roots, some twigs, fruits, and leaves. Prehensile-tailed porcupines can grow to be up to 40 inches in length, and about half of that is actually their tail, and then they can be about 9 pounds when they're full grown. Porcupines in the wild are usually solitary, which means they live by themselves, or they might live in male-female pairs. The two prehensile-tailed porcupines we have at this zoo are a male and a female, The male's name is Henry and the female's name is Zoe. They came to our zoo about 6 months ago from the Metro Richmond Zoo in Virginia, and they've been doing really well here. The female, Zoe, she's normally very quiet, and she'll kind of hang out in the corner of the exhibit while you're feeding. And then the male, Henry, he'll just come right up to you, and he'll sometimes try and climb your leg because he's so hungry. Prehensile tail porcupines in the wild are found in Brazil, Venezuela, and Argentina. Prehensile tail porcupines live in tropical rainforests. Prehensile tail porcupines spend almost all of their time in the trees. So they have some adaptations that help them with that. They have their long tail that they can use for grasping, and actually their feet have long claws on them and can kind of, their ankles can kind of be turned as they climb so that they're even better climbers than most porcupines are. Porcupine's quills are used for protection. A lot of times the animal will either curl up into a ball when it's threatened and point its quills up and away from its body so that a predator won't be able to actually get at it. What they don't do is actually shoot their quills at attackers. That's kind of an urban legend that a lot of people believe about porcupines, but they don't do that. Porcupine quills are actually modified hairs. They start out as hairs and then they're covered in plates of keratin, which is a special protein, so that they actually harden and form into quills. And quills are actually barbed, so they have a backward-facing barb on the end, so that when they are embedded in an animal's skin or something like that, they'll actually stay there. Prehensile tail porcupines are classified as least concern for their conservation status, and that means that they're doing really well in the wild, actually. They're not really under threat as of this point, so that's really good. They're also relatively easy to keep and breed in captivity, which helps maintain their conservation status.
Well, that's a really interesting animal.
Yes.
Up at my home in Maine,
yep.
I've actually had one right outside my door.
Cool.
And it doesn't look like those,
right,
because it doesn't have the tail that wraps around. It's,
yep,
more of a flat tail.
Right.
And I always did think they shot their quills because I would stay away from them.
Yeah, well, one thing also is, like, we mimic a lot of stuff that we see in nature. So if you go fishing, they put a little barb on the end,
yeah,
of the fish hook so that when you hook the lip, it doesn't pull out. So the same thing when...
It's the same idea.
When you get hit with a quill, it's going to stick in you and it's going to hurt pulling that out.
Yeah, I don't want to do that. Want to know more about this animal and others like it? Go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos.
Good.
All right, I have a lesson. It's all about order of operations still,
cool,
and it goes with what Tyler called in about.
Sounds
so
good.
I thought maybe if he's still watching, he can watch
all
a
right.
harder problem.
All right.
Okay? All right, so I created this really, really hard problem that would probably throw my seventh graders up in a tailspin because they would, there's too much here. Well, it's the same thing. Remember, we're going to just follow PEMDAS, BEMDAS, BEDMAS, however you say it. All right, this is what I grew up with, so it's what I usually always write as PEMDAS. So we got to do the parentheses first. But the reason I did this one is because there's order of operations within the parentheses. So even though I have to do the parentheses section first, I have to still follow the order of operations. All right, so we're going to go here. I got my parentheses. The next thing it says is exponents. So I have an exponent here, so I have to do that. So I'm going to carry my parentheses down. Not 3 squared is 9. Then add 16, divide 4, and just keep writing it. Because ultimately, it's going to sort of end up looking like a half a triangle. So now what I'm going to do is my next piece is the multiply and the divide. And remember, we do those left to right as we hit them. But we have to stay within the parentheses first. So there's no multiply. Oh, but I have this divide. So we're going to do 4 minus 9 plus 16 divided by 4 is 4. And then just keep rewriting. Don't forget to do that because you might forget a step if you don't bring it all down with you. So now we're in the parentheses, and now we're in the add subtract. And again, that's left to right. As you hit it, you do it. It's like reading a book. So we're going to do 4 minus 9, which is a negative 5 plus 4. Again, bring everything down with you. And then a minus 5 plus 4 is a minus 1. I'm done with my parentheses. They're gone. Then minus 8 minus 3 times 5. Now I've gotten rid of the parentheses, but now I got to go back to the order of operations and follow them again. So now what we're going to do is we're going to look, no more parentheses, no exponents, but we do have a multiply divide section. So we're going to do that part. So we have a minus 1, take away 8, take away 15. And now we just keep going. Negative 1, take away 8 is negative 9, take away 15. Negative 9, take away 15 is a negative 24. All right, so now I got a little creative with my lesson and I decided if you're on social media, there's all these problems out there that everyone answers, and it's funny to watch because you see all these people that are getting them wrong. So if you look at it just like a math problem, as if they were numbers, we follow them the same way. I have a snowman plus a snowman plus a snowman has to equal 30. Craig, what do you think that's going to be?
The snowmen are equal to 10 each.
Okay, because 10 plus 10 plus 10 gives me 30.
Yes.
Okay, good. So now we're going to bring it down just like we have a variable. So the 10 is going to go with the snowman, but I got to figure out what these snowflakes equal.
I would go 10 plus some number equals 20.
Okay.
I would move the snowman to the other side and subtract 10 from both sides.
Okay, so my two snowflakes equals how much?
5 each. Two snowflakes equals 10.
And so each one is?
5.
So each one of these is 5, because 10 plus 5 plus 5 is 20. Now bring it down to the next line. I know my snowflake is 5. Now I have got to have these two pieces here, look at them, they're identical. That has to equal 9. Well, 5 plus what gives you 9, Craig?
4.
Okay, so if I have two of them, how much is it?
Each set of trees is 2.
Each set of trees, I like how you said that, is equal to 2. So now this is where it gets really funny, because no one ever gets this one. They don't look at the pictures. We know that one snowman is 10. We know that one snowflake is 5, and then the times. But now, I had two trees up here to equal 2. I only have one tree down here at the bottom. So how much do you think one tree is, Craig?
1.
1. And now we have to follow our order of operations. What's the order of operations? We have to do the times before we do the addition. So you have 10 plus 5. What's 10 plus 5?
15.
So I love doing those kind of problems. They are so much fun, and I give them to my kids, and they're like, oh, that's too much, miss. But they do and are getting better at them. So I'm hoping you had some fun watching the problems.
Newton's third law states, for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction.
All right, we have a winner in tonight's creature teaser.
Yes, we do. Who are we talking with?
Hello?
Hi.
Hi.
All right, well, what were we talking about, Craig?
They're a red-tailed hawk.
The red-tailed hawk. Now, you live out in the country.
Yeah, about half a mile outside of the city,
and
or half an hour.
Do you see them at all?
Yeah, we see. I see them, and the interesting is you'll see them sitting up on top of the wire, and they literally just drop off the wire right down to the ground and hit something, and then next you know they see them with a snake or a mouse or something, and then they'll sit there for a minute and make sure that it's dead, and then they'll fly back up on the wire or wherever they're going
to. Well, they must have really good eyesight, because I couldn't sit anywhere that and see something and that
seen
tiny.
Glasses. No, not at all.
Cool. But I believe there's actually some that actually roost in some of the smokestacks, some of the warehouse type buildings as well.
Well, and the part of it is that as we've progressed across and built highways, we've opened up these areas between the lanes that are prime location for these kind of animals.
That's true.
The problem is they get so focused on those swoop across at what they're seeing and not see some car come by and you might hit them. So
yeah, you got to be careful about that.
Congratulations. Don't forget, every correct response goes into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all the time we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial-A-Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
Tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we kick off Black History Month by taking a closer look at Rochester's first professional African-American architect, Thomas Wilson Boyd, Jr. Good night.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.